Management Minute. Today we're down in the south central part of the state on Cross Timbers Wildlife Management Area. We're here with Brandon Baker, the biologist on the Wildlife Management Area. So Brandon, can you tell us a little history about the property and maybe the plans that you have for it?
Yeah, actually the history, it was actually an old cattle ranch and previously, and then we actually bought the property not too long ago, and actually we're in the process of converting old introduced pastures into native grasslands. So the reason for that is the Bermuda grass is not beneficial for wildlife whatsoever, so we're wanting to try to reestablish it back to native grass to enhance the wildlife habitat on the area.
Do you have any target species you guys are interested in down here?
Yeah, specifically, you know, bobwhite quail and like I said, some of the other ground nesting birds, Dick Sissel and grasshopper sparrow. But why we're interested in that is Bermuda grass, you know, it becomes a monoculture, and so you don't hardly ever see variety of forbs and legumes present, which isn't beneficial for wildlife. So what we're trying to do is establish these native grass areas so the ground nesting birds can utilize those for their nest, and also for specifically quail, you know, it creates some open ground where they can find seeds and insects and get around, and like I said, provides a lot better nesting structure for all of them.
And if a landowner is interested in converting the monoculture to a native grass, what would the process be?
Well, first you got to understand it's a lengthy process, so it's going to take some time to establish those native grasses to what you want. But basically what you start with is herbicide applications, and it depends on how thick the Bermuda grass is. You know, usually it takes at least a couple herbicide applications to really thin down the Bermuda grass, and you may not have, you know, eradicate it completely, but you can eliminate just about all of it. And we specifically on this area, we usually start out with using Roundup, the first application, to try to get a pretty good thorough kill. And then we try to follow up with clethodim, which is the grass killer. And we want to try to keep forbs and legumes and stuff present so it's not just bare ground.
What's the best time of year to do that herbicide treatment?
Soon as it starts greening up and growing season begins, it's actually a good time to start getting on it, you know, before it really gets, you know, robust and tall.
And after you've done your herbicide treatments throughout the growing season, what's the next step?
Well, generally in the fall, generally late August or so, we actually go in and disc those areas up, and then we actually plant a cover crop. You can plant all kinds of cover crops, but we plant wheat on this area, and so it's real easy to get established. The purpose of the cover crops that we plant is specifically for erosion, and then also to have that cover crop there for whenever we go plant the seeds in the spring. It keeps that seed from blowing, because that seed, you're just planting it barely below the surface, so there can be some wind disturbance on the seed dispersion. And then also that cover crop does add some extra benefit to holding moisture there in the ground where the seeds are.
And once your cover crop is established, what's the next step?
Well, once my wheat gets 5 to 6 inches tall there in the spring, I actually go back in with a herbicide treatment, Roundup, and spray it, because I want it basically to keep that height. And then now I'm ready to start planting my native grass seed.
So this project started a year ago, and we're just now putting the native grass seed in the ground?
It is a lengthy project, but it takes all those steps to actually make it work.
So do you use just a normal grain drill to?
No, you don't. You actually have to have a specific native grass seed box to actually be able to plant it. And I don't say if you want, I've got one on the back of my tractor.
Okay.
We'll go take a
look at it. Man, Brandon, this is a nice drill.
Yeah, it is. It has three different options of seeding styles. It has the legume box on front, and then it has just regular old grain box, and then it also has this native grass seed box. And the differences between these seed boxes, specifically on the native grass style, is it has agitators in here, because that native grass seed's real fluffy. And so anyways, it's got to be able to agitate that seed to get it dispersed down to the bottom of the box. And then it also has fingers down on the very bottom side that actually pulls that native grass down into those tubes to distribute it out the bottom of the drill.
Man, Brandon, this is some specialized equipment.
Yes, it is. It makes native grass planting a lot easier. And you can actually purchase this drill or drill like it, and then you can actually, drills are available at native grass seed distributors. You can actually rent equipment there, native grass seed drills, and then you can also get them at the conservation districts, and they're in each county. They're one county, they're conservation district in each county in the state.
Okay. So you get this planted, you know, this coming year. So what do you expect it to look like, you know, next year?
Well, good question. I've actually got a spot on the other side of the WMA that we can look at to show you exactly what it looked like in one growing season.
Okay.
All right, Doug, what we're looking at here is some native grass that I actually planted last year. So you can tell that we had a real good stand of what you're looking at here is switchgrass. And what you can see behind us is, like I said, primarily switchgrass with a few forbs that have come up. But the reason why it looks so good in just one year's growth is last year, if you remember, we had really good rainfall amount. So this isn't typically what you get in a normal year. But looking at this, like I said, it's a lot more beneficial from, like I say, what we talked about earlier, monoculture of Bermuda grass. It's a, you know, more of a bunch grass, which that's what we're looking at, you know, primarily working with, you know, is bobwhite quail and dick sisal, you know, a few other ground nesting birds. So that's why this is so much more beneficial from a wildlife standpoint.
Well, Brandon, thanks for having us out. And this has been your Management Minute.